If you've watched my previous video about gangs of thieves in Victorian London, you will already be familiar with John Bartholomew Gough. Check out that video for a brief introduction to his incredible life story. Suffice to say that, like Jack London decades later, Gough visited London and set about exploring the city, with an equal interest in both its wealth and the life of people living in poverty. He recorded his experiences and the conversations he witnessed with everyday people so that we can hear this genuine first-hand account of 19th century life in the metropolis today. In this video, we will learn how the poor skillfully took advantage of the city and its people to make some money to survive. Some of these methods were crafty, underhand, or downright dangerous, but all go to demonstrate the lengths many had to go to just to turn a penny and survive on London's streets. Before we start, please consider clicking the subscribe button in the bottom right of your screen for more content like this. If you find this video interesting, I would really appreciate it if you could give it a thumbs up and share it widely with friends and family. These two things really do show your support and help the channel grow so I can bring you more. Thank you. Check out the description for links to more interesting videos about the Victorians and take a look at the channel page for even more content. In London, there is an immense variety of methods for making money. A lady was one day driving along one of the green lanes that are still to be met with in the vicinity of London and saw a poor woman gathering some chestnut leaves. She stopped and asked for what purpose. The reply was that the leaves were sold to the fruiterers in Covent Garden to put in their baskets of fruit. On another occasion, it came out that women and children tore down the placards in the streets at night and thus made a trifle by selling them as waste paper. One man dives in the sewers for what may be washed away. A capitalist buys up all the dust and ashes of the city, and they are sifted by women so covered in soot and grimy that you could scarcely tell them to be women at all. There is no waste in London. Everything is picked up and turned to account. One man buys old bones, another old rags, another buys cigar ends for snuff. In short, there is nothing so mean or filthy but is made merchandise by the poor of London. One man advertises for old postage stamps that have been used on the pretense that some crusty old parent will not let his daughter marry till she has collected a million. The pretense is a hoax. The old stamps are pasted together and in some of the obscure parts of the town are offered you at a reduced price. The post office authorities have issued a new pattern of stamp because nearly one-third received had been cancelled and renewed. There are 500 or 600 boys and girls called mudlarks who live by searching the mud of the Thames for bones, coals and other articles. You often see men who may be called Jack of all trades, who run errands, hold your horse, reminding you of Billy Downey in The Unfinished Gentleman, who sold clothes props and pins. Then in the literary line, carrying round newspapers, spreading knowledge and information. Then in the vagabond line, an actor, performing the hind legs of the elephant 53 successful nights, till the chap what done the four legs and he happened to get into a fight, and the consequence was they upset the old concern. And in course he got the bag from the theatre, and now he holds horses, runs errands, blacks boots, and makes himself generally useful. Not long since, some children were poisoned by drinking some belladonna. It appears they had stolen it out of a case in the street off Covent Garden, had put it in a bottle with water, and sold it to other children at a pin for a spoonful, thinking the belladonna was Spanish licorice, and in this way had carried on an active business. Some of these little urchins are too restless and irritable to be easily reclaimed. The monotony of decent life is almost insupportable. If you reclaim them, many will contrive to get away again. A gentleman by the name of Driver, who had been for years engaged in endeavouring to reclaim these little rascals, says that on one occasion he met some of them, all dirt and rags, near the Nelson Monument. Said he,
"I addressed myself principally to one boy whom some time before I had pulled from underneath a tarpaulin in Covent Garden Market in the middle of a winter's night. He had been twice under my care for short periods, but gave the preference to a street life. I said, "Well, Jim, are you not tired of this sort of life?" "No," he answered with a grin. "Not yet. And when I am, sir, I will come to you."
"Very well," I replied. "I suppose you will have your game out first."
"Now, sir, I'll tell you the real truth. I'd come to you tomorrow if you'd give me an ounce of bacca a week, some halfpence in my pocket to spend, and an hour's holiday every day. It would not be worth my while to do it under that. It would not, indeed, sir."
All these ragged urchins have an object, and, I fear, but one object of terror, and that is a policeman. They will teach their dogs to bark furiously at the word bobby or peeler. They will tease them in all possible ways. A policeman brought a boy before a magistrate on a charge of insulting him.
What did he say to you?"
"Oh, he said nothing to me."
"What did he do?"
"Well, he pointed at me and asked another boy if he ever see a rabbit pie made out of mutton."
"Oh, I cannot entertain such a charge as that." At every accident to a policeman, their delight is uncontrollable.
"Jim, hoy, look here, come here, such a lark, hooray! Oh my, here's a policeman fell down on a slide, hooray!"
To a flashily dressed snob, they are very provoking.
"Oh my, hoy, there goes eightpence out of a shilling."
If on horseback, so much the worse.
"Hi there, you'll tumble off that chopboard."
If he is a timid rider.
"Billy, see, here's a swell. Let's frighten his horse."
As witty a thing as I ever heard was a remark made by one boy to another as a showily dressed person passed, evidently vain of his appearance.
"Hey, how does that here chap's hat stay up without nothing under it?"
Ask this ragged little wretch. "Can you read?"
"No, but I can stand on my head and drink a glass of gin,"
a judicious old lady said when a boy accosted her with, "Stand on me head, ma'am, for a penny." "No, little boy, there's a penny for keeping right side upwards." Another boy. "Now, my little man, what would you say if I should give you a penny?"
"Yeah, that you was a jolly old brick."
Punch gives some very graphic descriptions of this class of boys. A stroll through the streets amazes you at the variety of methods for turning a penny. Everything is a penny. Cigar lights, pencils, sham jewellery, ingenious puzzles and very questionable publications, which yield enormous profits, one of them realising for the ignoble owner many thousands a year. At one time it is the devil that is put for sale at the price of one penny, at another London Life, London Gossip or Town Talk. There is always a great sale of prints and photographs, all at one penny. The run on the evening papers, particularly when there has been a sensational murder or a divorce case with spicy details, is immense. And as edition after edition is worked off, the streets are filled with men and women, lads and girls offering them for sale. In this way, a good deal of money is made, especially by the vendors who manage to get first in the neighbourhood of the exchange and the mansion house, and thus reach a class of customers who are not particular in the matter of change. Unprotected females, as they walk down Cheapside, are exceedingly annoyed by the impertinence of some of these fellows who thrust the matrimonial news before them, as they bawl in stentorian tones, "One an husband, ma'am. Lots of husbands to be had. Only a penny." One thing to be noted is the temporary character of these penny saleable articles. Some are to be met with all the year round, such as studs, cigar lights, pocketbooks, diaries, almanacs, beetles, which, attached to an India rubber string, dance about as if they were alive. India rubber balls, specimens of geology, steel pens, notepaper, German toys, refreshing drinks, bird whistles, etc. Others are dependent on the season, and you get wonderful flowers, camellias made of turnips, apples, pears, oranges, walnuts, and slices of pineapple. And the costermongers who thus cater for the million are indeed a blessing, as they supply the poor of the metropolis with cheap fruit. In the summer, you have the retailer of sherbet and the penny ice and shellfish. In the winter, the same man deals in roasted chestnuts or baked potatoes or keeps a coffee stall. All the year round, some enterprising individuals supply the public who need to have their blood purified with penny sarsaparilla drinks. When Lord Beaconsfield came back from the Berlin Congress, there was a card hawked about called the European Mystery, and the puzzle was to find Lord Beaconsfield in the picture.